Welcome students, this is a new topic that we are going to discuss on today, that is thyristor commutation techniques. So the word commutation means turning off a particular device. So let us study that what are the different methods of commutations. So basically commutations are two types. One is the natural commutation and another is the forced commutation. Like, what is natural commutation? If we go to this circuit, suppose let us take the example of this circuit. So basically it is a supply voltage which is AC. It is connected to a thyristor T, and in series to that we have a load resistance R. So what is the nature of the supply? It is sinusoidal, like this. So in order to turn off a particular thyristor, we have to have some criteria, that is reverse voltage. Across thyristor T. This is number one. Number two, the current across the thyristor, if we take that as IT, that should be zero. So if these two criteria are met, then that particular thyristor is said to be turned off or commutated. So for AC supply, there is a natural reverse voltage that is already being there, and this reverse voltage in the negative half cycle, that is responsible for turning off that particular thyristor, and it is known as natural commutation. So natural commutation are applicable for AC voltage controllers, phase control rectifiers and cyclo converters. So wherever AC is involved, there is opportunity of getting natural commutation. So the thyristor enjoys the natural commutation process. So the other is a forced commutation. So what is forced commutation? So here, so forced commutation means there should be no natural zero. There should be no natural zero of the waveform. Why? Because the supply which is applicable, it is a DC supply, and DC have no zero. And for that, we have to rely on some external circuit that has to be connected across the thyristor to turn that particular device off. That means forcefully we have to add one circuit across the thyristor where the natural voltage which is not available, that means the zero natural voltage which is not available, that zero voltage or reverse voltage rather, we are applying artificially or forcefully. That's why the method is called forced commutation. And forced commutation, you always remember, that is always applicable for DC supply. So now, this is the normal waveforms of a phase controlled rectifier, a single phase controlled rectifier. And here you can see in a cycle, how many natural zeros are there? 2. In the second half cycle also it is 2. And during these natural zeros, zero crossings are experienced, the thyristors are automatically turned off. So if you see the output voltage, after this we are not getting any output. Why? Because automatically the thyristor which is there, it is getting reverse biased. And for that we need not connect an external circuit. So forced commutation, they are applicable for DC circuits, DC to DC converter, that is the chopper, and DC to AC converter, that is an inverter. So you must observe that wherever DC supply is there, forced commutation has to be there. That means we have to design some external circuit to forcefully turn off the thyristors which are there in the circuit. So commutation achieved by reverse biasing the SCR or by reducing the SCR current below the holding current value. That means in order to turn up the thyristor, the holding current, the current which is flowing, that should go below the holding current. That is one of the criteria. The commutating elements such as inductance and capacitance are used for commutation purpose. So what are the different types of forced commutation? Number one, self commutation. Number two, resonant pulse commutation. Number three, complementary commutation. Number four, impulse commutation. Number five, external pulse commutation. And number six, line commutation. So let us study the first type of commutation, that is the class A commutation. So let us observe each and individual feature one by one. So it is a series circuit. So a supply voltage is there. In series to that we have a thyristor T. In series to that we have an inductor L, a capacitor C, and a load resistance R. And there may be two configuration possible. The C and R may be connected in parallel, they may be connected in series. And you have to remember the other names for this type of commutation. It is also called self commutation and load commutation. That means in your examination, instead of class A, if it is coming that write about load commutation or write about self commutation, that means you have to write about class A commutation. So all the different names you have to remember. And there is an important thing, that we take the advantage of an LC circuit in all these types of commutation. So for that, the next question that comes is, why an LC circuit? So let us study an LC circuit. So this is an LC circuit. The supply voltage is DC, remember, because we are dealing with forced commutation. If your supply voltage is DC, so what will be the output voltage? That is our point of concern. The output voltage will be a purely sinusoidal voltage. And this type of circuit is called an oscillating circuit. This type of circuit is called an oscillating circuit, and this is the waveform of your output voltage. So this property we are going to make use in case of commutation techniques. And in all the types of commutation that we will see, we will find that we have made use of this LC circuit. So there are few points which are discussed over here. When R is low, L and C are connected in series with R. When R is high, C is connected in parallel with R. So these are useful for DC circuits, and the system should be underdamped. So how can we underdamp a system? By connecting a series resistance with R. Because from control system knowledge, we know that R increases the damping of the system. So the output across the LC circuit, which was a purely sinusoidal output, now the output will be a damped sinusoidal output. That means the output voltage V0 will decay and it will gradually die out. So as soon as the output current and the output voltage dies out, the device, that is the thyristor T, they will turn off. Because R is responsible for that. When energized from a DC source, the current must have a natural tendency to decay to zero. The change in direction of the current makes the thyristor turn off. And I have already told you that the current is oscillating in nature. That means it is bipolar. The SCR is turned off when the current is zero. Next is the self commutation. This circuit which we have just seen, we will analyze this. So again I will describe the circuit. A supply voltage is there. The thyristor, which is our point of concern, it is there. In series to that we have an R, an L and C. And the C is initially charged with a particular voltage with this polarity. So now if we analyze this circuit, we can apply KVL in this particular loop. And what is your current? It is IS. That means the thyristor is closed, that means it is on. That means VS minus IS into RS minus, what is the Laplace transform of an inductor? It is LS. That means IS into LS minus IS into 1 by CS minus VC0 by S. And if we want to find the magnitude of IS by changing sides, we will get this equation. And simplifying the circuit or bringing the circuit in a particular form, we will get this particular equation. Remember, if we find the value in terms of IS, it will not suffice. It is for your ease of calculation, but we have to transform it from S domain to time domain. That we have to do in the end. So before taking the inverse Laplace transform, which is applicable for converting from S domain to T domain, we have to arrange the equation in a particular format, which we are doing over here. And obviously, by assuming some constants, that means this particular parameters, they are replaced by A. This is your natural frequency, damped frequency rather, it is natural frequency, which is given by omega, and this is your delta, that is the damping ratio, and you see it is consisting of R. So if we substitute all these parameters in this equation, we will land up with this equation. And now we can take the inverse Laplace transform. And what is the output? It is a damped sinusoidal output. Because sin omega t is there and a decaying exponential component is there. So if we take the sine wave, this will be your response. And if we superimpose the envelope like this, of e to the power minus delta t, we will get the output waveform like this. That means the current is decaying to zero. And what is the peak value of the current? The peak value of the current is V minus VC0 by omega L. Now, for effective commutation, your circuit should be underdamped. That means, if you go to the equation of omega, which I have shown in the previous slide, for underdamped, R square by 2L should be less than LC. with R equal to 0, the capacitor initially is uncharged, that is Vc0 equal to 0. And you will get this equation. And what will be the current? The current will be V root CL sine T by root LC. You remember this particular equation. V root C by L sine T by root LC. Once the SCR turns off, the voltage across it is a negative voltage. So we have to impress a negative voltage across the SCR in order to turn it off. So this is how we are developing a negative voltage across the SCR by means of an LC circuit. So the second type of commutation is called class B commutation. It is also called resonant pulse commutation. So here, where is the LC circuit? Here is the LC circuit. So the series LC circuit is connected across the thyristor T1 that we have done. And initially the capacitor, that is C, it is charged with the left plate positive and the right plate negative. It is initially charged. And when the SCR is turned on, that means T, it behaves like an oscillating circuit. It behaves like an oscillating circuit. That means the output of this LC circuit, it is a sinusoidal output. So what is happening? Let us see the waveform. So when you are giving a supply, how does the current flow? The positive side of Vs through T1 through the load back to Vs, and from here through the LC, through the diode, through the load and back. And in this course, if we see the polarity, the left plate is positive and the right plate is negative. So if we observe the current, so here you are applying a gate pulse to the thyristor T1, which is turned on, and we are getting a constant load current at the output. So at the instant T1, what we are doing, we are turning on this thyristor TA, and then what will happen? The capacitor will be discharged. Like this. And the supply is again connected over here. So what will happen to the capacitor voltage? You see that the capacitor voltage will reduce, it will become zero. And since it is an LC circuit, it will go to the negative peak. That means this will be positive and this will be negative. Now when this happens, what happens to TA? You can see that TA is experiencing this voltage. This is positive, this is negative. So TA will be reverse biased and it will turn off first. And after some time, at point T2, TA will be off. What about at T3? This negative voltage will also be impressed over T1 and T1 will also be off. So which is the only path left? This is the only path that is left. And again the capacitor will be charging from like this. I will again show you. These two are off. And the capacitor will be again charged with this plate positive and this plate negative. So you can see the capacitor voltage from T2 will again rise, it will cross 0 and again rise to Vs. And this cycle will continue again. So T1 here is called the main thyristor and TA is called the auxiliary thyristor. That means the auxiliary thyristor is operating the thyristor T1. It is helping the thyristor T1 to turn on and turn off in proper sequence as and when required. IT1 is the current through the thyristor and IC is the capacitor current. So you see, when the thyristor T1 is off, IT1 becomes 0 at this point. So these waveforms you have to analyze. If you understand this waveform, then you will understand the operation of this circuit. So what about I0? We have derived this equation. It should be I0 is equal to Vs root C by L sine omega 0 into T3 minus T2. Now why T3 minus T2? Let us again come back to the waveform. You see that here between T3 and T2 it is maintaining the sinusoidal pattern. So we can apply sine omega 0 into T3 minus T2. And what is the peak value? The peak value is Vs root C by L. So what is omega 0? Omega 0 is equal to sine inverse I0 by IP by T3 minus T2. Let us again go back to this slide. So if we go back to this slide, you can see that this is theta. And if we take T3 minus T2, this particular duration, that is this particular duration, then what is the voltage? That is VAB over here. That means this value. This is VAB. That means that this is the capacitor voltage. And the time interval between T3 minus T2, that is theta. And if you observe the current, this particular current is I0. So this is a right angle triangle whose perpendicular distance is I0 and the base is T3 minus T2. That means this particular width. So now definitely from this right angle triangle we can derive this particular equation. That means sine inverse I0 by IP, that will give you some angle. That means the theta you will be obtaining, and when you are dividing this theta by time, it will give you the omega 0, that is the angular frequency. What is the peak value of current IP? It is equal to Vs root C by L. It is obtained from here only. And TC, this is very important, it is called the circuit turn off time. That is T4 minus T3. So let us again go back to the waveform. So where is T4 minus T3? So here it is T4 minus T3. This particular width, it is T4 minus T3. So what is the perpendicular distance over here? It is VAB. That means the this is the capacitor voltage VAB. So if you multiply this VAB into C into VAB, so if you are multiplying them, you will get the charge Q stored in the capacitor. And if you divide this charge Q divided by this time interval, that means T4 minus T3, or rather you will get the current I. So T4 minus T3, that is equal to Q by I. What is Q? This is equal to CVAB by I. So this is the equation which you are getting. And what is VAB? VAB is equal to VS cos omega 0 T3 minus T2, because T3 minus T2 during this interval, it is following a sinusoidal pattern. And now why cosine? Because it is starting from maximum. That means this pattern is always a cosine. So this commutation is also called, another name for this type of commutation is resonant pulse commutation. Now this is the third type of commutation, that is class C commutation or complementary commutation. Let us physically try to understand what is happening. After that we will go to the equations and waveform. So you see there are two, it is also called an H type circuit. This type of circuit is also called an H type circuit because for this arrangement it looks like an H. So here in the left leg of H you are having R1 and T1 connected in series, and in the right leg you are having R2 and T2, they are also connected in series. And in the midpoint of these two, a capacitor C is acting as a bridge. It is also called a bridge capacitor. This completes the H circuit. So when the thyristor T1 is turned on, how will the current flow? It will flow like this, from VS through R1 to T1 back to negative. Again, from the positive through R2, through C, through T1, and again back to negative. So in this course the capacitor will, the right plate will be positive and the left plate will be negative. Now at this point I want to turn off T1. So in order to turn off T1, I have to turn on T2. As soon as I turn on T2, this particular area will be short circuited. And you see that this capacitor with this specific polarity will appear or connected across T1. That means the polarity that is experienced by T1 is the upper part negative and the lower part positive. So what is its condition? It is reverse biased. As soon as it is reverse biased, it will turn off. Now this is turned off. Now how will be the current flowing? That means during this time T2 is on. So now the current will flow from positive through R2 through T2 back to the negative. Again, there is another path from the positive through R1 through C through T2 back to the negative. What will be the polarity of the capacitor? As the current is flowing from left to right through C, the left plate will be positive and the right plate will be negative. And now your IC deduction will be in this particular direction. Now after some time of operation, I wish to turn off T2. In order to turn off T2, I need to turn on T1. I give a gate pulse to T1. As soon as T1 is turned on, this area becomes shorted. And the capacitor with this polarity is applied on T2. That means this negative will be coming over here and this positive will be coming over here. So what is the condition or state of T2? It is reverse biased. It is again turned off. That means one thyristor is complementing the turning off of another device, and hence it is called complementary commutation. I hope it is now clear. So these are few equations which are given over here, and all these equations will be helpful for solving your numerical problems which will be given to you. So when T1 is on, this is the equations which are governing the operation of T1. So IR1 should be equal to VS by R1, that is the current through the resistor when T1 is on. It is a purely resistive circuit, that is I1. What about I0 or IC? So initially I0, that means at t equal to 0, the capacitor is short circuited, because at t equal to 0 a capacitor behaves like shorted, so it should be VS by R2. So that means I1, which is flowing like this in the entire circuit, that means the total current of the circuit I1, that is equal to IT1 plus IC. KCL. If you apply KCL at this point, we will get this. So that means this VS by R2 is the initial current. But what about the final current? It will be a decaying current like this. So this value is VS by R2. So if you substitute T equal to 0 over here, so it will be VS by R2, that is IC0. But for time t, at any time t, the current will be VS by R2 e to the power minus T by R2C. This is the equation of a current through an RC circuit. We all know this equation. So now you substitute this value over here and you will be getting the value of IC, that means the, or I1, that is the current through the capacitor, or the current through the thyristor, you can also say that, because this is the total current is flowing through the thyristor. So what about the capacitor voltage? It is an RC circuit, so VC equal to VS into 1 minus e to the power minus T by R2C, because this is an RC circuit. So this is for when T1 is on. So you remember, at T equal to 0, for the first time of operation, the capacitor is uncharged. Remember these lines. For the first time of operation, the capacitor is uncharged. Now for subsequent operations, the capacitors are initially charged with a particular voltage, that is VS. That means At t equal to 0, Vc equal to 0. At t equal to 0. But after every time, the capacitor will be charged with some voltage. And remember, it is not 0. The stored charge is not 0. So you have to take care of this particular thing for every subsequent cycles. So let us go to the next slide. So now when a reverse voltage is applied across the thyristor T1, it is turned off and the current through the capacitor will change its direction. Why? Because when T1 is off, let us study this, when T1 is off, now the current, initially the direction of the current was given by the dotted line, now it will be given like this. So the current has got reversed. It will be now like this. It will flow through T2 and another current will flow through R2 through T2 back to the load. This will be the direction of the current when T1 is off and T2 is on. Now what will happen? So what about IT2? IT2 is equal to 2VS by R1. Why? Because VS was, or the capacitor was initially charged. So 2VS by R1. 1 due to the charged capacitor and 1 due to the supply voltage. That's why 2VS by R1 plus VS by R2. This will be your IT2. So if you apply KVL, you will get this equation, R1 into IC, that means the RC circuit if you apply KVL and VS, R1 into IC plus 1 by C integration IC dt is equal to VS. You take Laplace transform and you subsequently take the inverse Laplace, you will get the value of IC. So now, what will be the voltage across the capacitor? The current across the capacitor is this, it is a decaying current, but remember initially it was Vs by R e to the power minus t by RC, now it is 2Vs because of this initially charged capacitor. Now the voltage across the capacitor Vc is equal to Vs into 2 e to the power minus t by R2C minus 1, this 2 is also coming due to the initially charged capacitor. And similarly, after the T2 becomes off and T1 becomes on, the equation or the voltage equation of VT1, it will be like this. This 2 will always remain. So the value of R2 is shifted to R1. Now, what will be the circuit turn of time? The circuit turn of time will be, that means when the voltage will be 0, that means the voltage will be reversed. From here, if we take the logarithm, we will get the circuit turn off time for the thyristor T1 and T2 respectively, and they are given by R1C ln2 and R2C ln2. You just equate this equation with 0 and you will end up in this particular equation. So these are the waveforms. So you observe the current through the thyristor. So these are the different gate pulses. This is the gate pulse for thyristor 1, this is the gate pulse for thyristor 2. Now you observe that initially at t equal to 0, when the capacitor is uncharged, IT was operating or T1 was operating. So this is the current waveform. This slope is due to the RC circuit and this is for the purely R1 circuit. But after the completion of the first cycle, and here if you observe IT2, because after commutation of IT1, IT2 was operating. So from here you see that the two factor came, and the similar pattern of waveform was observed over here. Only the two factor is here. Now after this waveform, all waveforms are associated with this two factor. And what about VC? VC is continuously charging like this, discharging like this, and again charging like this. And TC1 and TC2 are derived in the previous slide from these two equations. This is TC1, that means the circuit turn of time for T1, and TC2 is the circuit turn of time for T2. If you equate this equation to 0, that means at this point you will get the value of T, that means TC2. From here, if you equate this particular equation to 0, you will get the value of TC1. And what about the capacitor current? It will be discharging like this, only the capacitor current. So you can see T1 and T2 are turned on and off simultaneously, that means complementarily. So you always remember that this particular circuit is nothing but a sequential RC circuit. Why sequential? Because it depends on how we are turning on and turning off this T1 and T2. So it is dependent on the sequence of IG1 and IG2. So accordingly these two circuits will operate, that means IT1 and IT2 will operate, T1 and T2 will operate accordingly. So the next type of commutation is class D commutation, or it is also called impulse commutation. So let us observe the circuit. You have a supply voltage Vs. In series to that you have a thyristor T1, you have a load. And a forced commutation circuit is connected across the thyristor T1. So obviously there has to be two components, one is L and another is C. And in order to operate this LC circuit, you have to connect a auxiliary thyristor. So one thing I would like to mention here, that in class B commutation also you had a diode like this, and the purpose of the diode is to maintain unidirectional flow of current through the circuit. So when T1 is on, I0 flows through the battery. So this is the flow of current. And the capacitor is initially charged with a particular voltage Vs. So at T equal to 0, you see the capacitor is initially charged. Now as soon as the capacitor is charged, it is initially charged, so the capacitor will, as soon as T1 is on, the capacitor will discharge through the circuit like this. And obviously the voltage through the capacitor will go from positive to negative Vs. That means the polarity of the capacitor will change like this, because it is an oscillating circuit. Now as soon as you turn on TA at this point, that means at this point, what will happen? This polarity will be induced to the thyristor T1, that means this will be minus and this will be plus, because this will be short circuited. This entire voltage will go across the thyristor T1. So what will be the state of T1? It will be reverse biased and T1 will be off. As soon as T1 will be off, what will happen? The current will now, so this is off, this is on. So the current will now flow like this through the load. So what will be the polarity? It will go from negative to positive. Initially it was like this. So at this point we are turning on TA. So this will be the polarity. So the capacitor will be charged like this. And as this particular T1 is off, this entire polarity will be induced on TA like this. And you can see that the capacitor, after TA is on, it will be, the voltage will increase from negative to positive. So this will be the voltage polarity. But if you see the polarity of TA, this particular polarity is opposite. So this will be directly impressed on TA. This will be negative, this will be positive. And at this point, what is happening? TA is turned off. So that means initially T1 was on at T equal to 0. At T1, thyristor T1 was off and thyristor TA is on. And at T2, thyristor TA becomes off and your circuit operation is complete. So initially, what will be the current through the thyristor T1? So it will be, due to the supply voltage, I will just clear this. The initial current through the thyristor, it will be from the positive through T1 through the load and back to the load. And also this capacitor was initially charged, it will also give some current through the load. That means IT1 should be equal to IC plus I0. So what will be IC? This equation we are already familiar of. Vs root C by L sine omega 0t. That means it will be IP sine omega 0t, where IP is the peak current. So if we substitute the value over here, we will get this equation where omega 0 is equal to 1 by root LC. So the peak capacitor voltage Vc, that is equal to 1 by C integration 0 to T of IL dt, IL into T of by C. That means C is equal to, again that particular format, that means C is equal to IL T of by Vc. And what will be the peak current? Vs root C by L. And these are the operating limits. Vs root C by L should be less than Imax. These are the values of the inductor that should be chosen. And this type of commutation is called an voltage commutation or impulse commutation. So the last type of commutation is called the external pulse commutation. So this method of commutation is used a pulse obtained from an external source to the main circuit to obtain a pulse forming network fed by an auxiliary voltage source. So this is the auxiliary voltage source. That means this is your main circuit. This is the main circuit. This is your auxiliary circuit. and this is the thyristor which will be turning off this, which will help to turn off this thyristor T1. So let us understand the operation of this circuit. So this is an LC circuit. So when you are applying a DC voltage like this to the LC circuit, what will be the voltage? And the thyristor is there, it will be a unidirectional voltage, that will be 2VAUX. This will be the voltage across the capacitor. This capacitor voltage will be 2V into AUX. So now this will be the polarity. So as soon as you turn on this T2, what will happen? This polarity will be induced over here. That means what will be the voltage here? 2V AUX, and the voltage will be such that this voltage will be greater than this voltage. So as soon as this voltage is greater than this voltage, the net voltage across the thyristor will be minus Vs minus 2V AUX. That means this thyristor will be reverse biased and it will turn off. It's a very simple circuit. Only thing, the operation has to be clear. So let us study the steps. So T1 is conducting and RL is connected across the supply. This was the actual circuit. So T3 is fired and C is charged to 2VAUX with the upper plate positive and the lower plate negative. And the T3 will self commutate and it will turn off because it is an oscillatory circuit. To turn off T1, this is very important, T2 has to be fired. So the net voltage across the thyristor T1 will be this, which is negative, and the thyristor T1 will be off. So we have discussed all the different types of commutation, and if you have any questions you can call me and you can post any queries in the comment section of your Google Classroom, or you can post your comments in the YouTube link that is shared. Thank you.